with our spirit. Did you venture?
Yeah.
Is that dragnet?
The wicking one?
Yeah.
Wicking the dragon one.
Witching
Michael,
venture?
You want Thunder Bench?
Oh, yeah. Wicking Vicker. I love it.
The Wicking Vicker? Yeah, I know, right?
What would you think? I hope that the sun's not in my eyes.
Fine, you're there. Make a joke of it. You know, something.
One minute. Just like when Moses' face shines.
That's right. You tell them their faces are shining so much.
I've been reading Exodus so much. My face is just.
The Lord showed me His glory and. All right, folks. What is this here? It looks like there's some blue.
Oh,
over.
So these stages are actually.
I'm gonna take this.
Don't need it. Don't need it.
All right, Brian, why don't you go ahead? We're going. Hang on. Okay, we're good.
10 seconds. Yep.
You're good to go, Brian.
Friends, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And what a day we have been given to be together. I believe the colors are at about peak, and the fellowship is also right about peak for today. It'll be good and it will be wonderful. It is good to have Brian back on the bagpipes, and I'm sure some of you are very glad we're worshiping outside today because of the fact, but... It's all good. It is all good. Welcome to Camp Wakanda. Welcome to Sabbath worship. Welcome to the the company of the faithful as we gather to give thanks and praise to God on this, the day before the Sabbath day, but for us, indeed, the Sabbath day. Let us join together in our call to worship. Lord, you have welcomed us, saying, I know you by name. You have found favor with me. Lord, you have promised us, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Lord, you have blessed us, saying, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you. Lord, you have humbled us, saying, I will proclaim my holy name in your presence. Lord, show us your glory. We worship you.
Please join us in singing hymn number 12, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Please stand.
Friends, would you please join me in our prayer of the day? Faithful God, you are here. Tuck us into the cleft of the rock. Cover us with your hand when we are anxious, that we may be courageous to do your will, through Christ who calls us by name. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Let us now confess our sin, casting ourselves on the promised mercy and compassion of God. Holy One, we confess to you and to each other that we are tired and weighed down by the mistakes we have made, even in our closest relationships with our friends, our spouses, and our partners. We give this burden to you, mindful of Jesus' promise that he will give us rest. We trust in you. Amen.
No. upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
And let us stand to receive the words of assurance. The Lord said to Moses, "There is a place near me where you may stand upon a rock. When my glory passes by, I'll put you in a cleft in the rock. I'll cover you with my hand until I have passed by." Beloved ones, God has shielded us, covered our sin with a hand of protection as we hide ourselves in Christ, the rock of our salvation.
Lord, I'll be ever thankful. In the Lord I will rejoice. Look to God, do not be afraid. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near.
Good morning. So for the children's sermon, I wanted to talk about, do you ever feel like you're having a hard morning, a hard day, a hard week, a hard year? Maybe you're in a fight, having a hard time in school, things aren't going how you planned, missing someone you love, or sad about something. Or maybe you just have a case of the grumps. Does that ever happen to you? The grumps. I know that happens to me. Sometimes you might feel like you need a little pep talk. You know, a talk to make you feel a little better or know you can do it. Hopefully you have someone in your life who gives you a good pep talk. A parent who says, "I know it's hard, but I know you can do it." A coach who says, "It's a tough team, but you have the skills. Get out there." A friend who says, "You are the coolest and you've got this." Or maybe you just tell yourself, "I think I can, I think I can." Well, one of our Bible verses today can be like a pep talk for us. Paul is writing a letter to the Philippians. And guess what? He is having a hard time too. He's in jail and is writing a letter to people who are being persecuted or being treated poorly because of their faith. He gives them a challenge to not give in to fear and to live their faith. So let's see what he says. So this is in Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9. And it says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing these things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you." So it's a pretty good pep talk. Paul says several things. He says, rejoice in everything. We can find joy in every situation. And this is coming from someone who's in jail. Don't be anxious. Bring everything to God in prayer. And think about the things that are good. You will have God's peace. So when you need that pep talk, let's remember to rejoice, and God's peace will be with us. Let's pray. Dear God, help me to rejoice. Remind me to pray about everything. Remind me to think about good things. Give me your peace. Amen.
As we prepare our hearts to approach God's holy word, let us pray that the Spirit would give us illumination. Comforting God, by your Holy Spirit, lift the burdens from our souls through the reading of your word for us, that we may learn how easy it is to live in a loving relationship with you. Amen. Our Hebrew scripture reading for this morning comes to us from the book of Exodus, the 33rd chapter, where we read about Moses' intercession. Let us listen now to the word of the Lord. Moses said to the Lord, "You have been telling me, 'Lead these people,' but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, 'I know you by name, and you have found favor with me.' If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways, so that I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people." The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Then Moses said to him, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" And the Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you and I know you by name." Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all of my goodness to pass in front of you. I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock, and when my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen." Sisters and brothers, this is the word of the Lord.
Well, our epistle reading, as we heard from Bonnie earlier, comes to us from Philippians chapter 4. I know my grumps are already gone, but in case yours are not, we hear again the word of the Lord. "Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. And the God of peace will be with you." Sisters and brothers, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand and join us as we sing hymn 649, "Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound." Thank you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Well, to keep up with the same theme here, Jesus does not appear to have the grumps. He does have a grateful heart. He is thankful this morning. And at the end of the reading, we're going to see that he has, well, he's up one to Paul's pep talk. We read the most pepped up talk there is to be offered. Let us listen to the gospel of the Lord. Jesus is the focus. At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth, the meditation of all of our hearts, prove acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So throughout our Exodus sermon series, we have ventured closely alongside the Israelites. We praised the first act of civil disobedience by the protesting midwives. We kneeled in awe alongside Moses at the burning bush. We savored the taste of the Passover meal before getting out of Dodge. Then we oohed and aahed at the parting of the sea. We kvetched against Moses when our stomachs grumbled. We received and agreed to follow those Ten Commandments, but then we got antsy. We got the grumps, I think. We were jealous. We were jealous that Moses was on top of the mountain gabbing with God while we were slumming it down at the bottom of Mount Sinai. And so we crafted a golden calf so that we could see a God and worship it too. And this made God angry. God was ready to consume all of us, killing us for our sin, just like back in the time of Noah. God even offered to make a new nation from Moses, but instead, Moses kept his cool. And acting as a mediator, he reminded God of the promises made to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. God had already promised to make their descendants into a great nation. Because of Moses's pleas, Yahweh changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. But when Moses came down from the mountain, and when he saw what we had done with his own eyes, he lost his cool. He also became enraged, throwing down the first tablets of the law, destroying the golden calf, and punishing us for its creation. So we read at the start of Exodus 33, where God tells Moses and the people, leave Mount Sinai, pack up and get to the promised lands, saying, I will send an angel before you, but I will not go up among you, or I would consume you on the way, for you are a stiff-necked people. So far, God had accompanied the people in this long exodus from Egypt, but now it seems that God would delegate their care to an angel. Hearing all of this, the people begin to mourn. And then Moses, the mediator, steps in again, seeking to bargain with God and maybe even change God's mind just one more time, even though God just told him. Moses asks, who will accompany us on this journey? The Lord had already promised an angel would lead the way, but for Moses, this isn't enough. So Moses boldly asks the Lord to accompany them on their journey to the promised land. Moses says, you have said to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, you have found favor in my sight. Now, if I have really found favor in your sight, show me your ways so that I may know you. And don't forget, this nation is your people. God responds, my presence will go, and I will give you rest. What's clear to me is that Moses is trying to gain reassurance. Reassurance of God's covenant, faithfulness, and favor towards God's chosen people. After interceding the first time and stopping God from repeating a flood-level extinction event, and then interceding a second time, getting God to commit to continue accompanying them on their journey, I'd have to imagine at this point Moses is probably feeling pretty good. Through his prayers, Moses has wrestled with God and has prevailed. God changed God's mind, not once, but twice. And since he was finding such great favor in God's eyes and almost as a way of sealing the deal, Moses ups the ante. And Moses asks God for something unprecedented. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. How I wish that we could all have been on the mountain that day to witness this scene. Show me your glory. But what exactly is Moses even asking for? In the Hebrew, the word is kavod, which is a rich term meaning everything from heaviness and importance to honor, respect, abundance, and yes, even glory. And I think that Moses wanted to behold the Lord fully. He wanted to see God all decked out in royal robes and to clearly behold God's radiant, beautiful face. But it seems that Moses oversteps the bounds a little with this request, because the Lord doesn't directly answer him and instead says, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you. I will proclaim my name, Yahweh. But you cannot see my face, for no one can see me and live. There's a place near me where you may stand upon a rock, and when my glory passes by, I'll put you in a cleft in the rock, covering you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand, and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen. And as I have been meditating on this passage over the last few weeks, I find myself returning to the same question. What is Moses' motivation? Why does Moses want to even see God's glory? And this has made me further consider all of our prayers. Why do we pray? Why do we ask God for particular things? What is our motivation? For Moses, his earlier prayer seemed to have been motivated by a concern for the nation of Israel and a desire to gain reassurance that God would accompany them through the wilderness. But for this last request, when Moses says, show me your glory, what is he hoping to achieve? Is he hoping to come down the mountain with bragging rights? You won't believe what I just saw. Or is Moses... Really, that's superficial? Perhaps instead, there's some deeper reason behind Moses' request. But to really further consider that, I want to think about some of the prayer requests that we sometimes offer up. Sometimes, we pray for things. We pray for tchotchkes and knickknacks and brand new cars. And I would argue that those kinds of requests are often superficial, not all the time, but often. And rarely do those kinds of prayers get answered for God, because our motivation is our own satisfaction, our possession, our happiness. Sometimes we pray for other people, especially friends and family struggling in a particular way, for health, addiction, a broken relationship. And here our motivation comes from a deeper place. Concern for another, wholeness of mind or body, and reconciliation. I believe that here our desire and God's will intersect. And while these types of prayers may not always be answered as quickly as we would like, or in this exact way that we want, I believe that God does hear these prayers, and God acts upon them. And sometimes we pray for ourselves, be that healing, more patience, some spiritual insight, or something of this nature. Our motivation, again, here comes from a desire to grow in faith, to continue on this journey toward God. And again, I believe God hears these prayers and acts upon them, but often the answers come in God's way, and certainly in God's time. One of my favorite new authors is a pastor by the name of Brian Zond. He speaks prophetically to many issues facing the church today. And in his book, Sinners in the Hands of a Loving God, Brian Zond tells a story about how in his early days of ministry, he prayed over and over that God would give him a vision, a particular vision. Brian Zond wanted a vision of hell. He claims that he must have prayed this same prayer thousands of times. Why? Morbid curiosity? There may have been a bit of that, he writes, but there was also a more noble motivation. Somehow I thought if I could witness the suffering of the damned, it would help me to be a better preacher of the gospel. So after praying to see hell for years to no avail, I finally gave up, forgot all about it. And it was many years later that I realized my youthful and no doubt naive prayer had actually been answered. I had seen hell. I had even visited hell more than once. As clearly as Dante or John the Revelator, I have seen the burning abyss. I have seen hell as I walked through the slums of India and Haiti, witnessing firsthand dehumanizing poverty in rat-infested shanty towns with open sewers and cardboard hovels. I've seen the chronicles of hell documented and cataloged in the Yad Vashem, the World Holocaust Remembrance Center in Jerusalem. I've seen hell in Gaza City as I sat with Palestinian people who live in a real-life Gehenna as they struggle to survive in the broken skeletons of bombed-out buildings. I prayed to see hell, and God sent me to India, Haiti, Israel, Gaza, Nigeria, Honduras, Mexico, and Missouri. I've seen the refugee camps dotting the shores of the Lake of Fire. Yes, I've seen hell, and just as I suspected so long ago, it does compel me to preach the good news of Jesus and invite everyone into the city of the Lamb. And so I want to return to our original question. What was Moses' motivation when he asked God, "Show me your glory"? First, what were his circumstances? Let's consider that. Moses was facing a difficult time with people who had just made a golden idol and who were daily complaining and kvetching to him. He didn't sign up for this job. God called him to lead these people. Now, seeing God's glory, that might give Moses the encouragement and inspiration to continue to lead the people strongly all the way to the promised land. But then, similar to Brian Zahn's request to see hell, I've also come to believe that Moses' motivation was truly transformation. Seeing God's glory might transform Moses' own life of faith and dedication to the Lord. In some ways, just like the people of Israel who had wanted to see a God with their own eyes and so crafted the golden calf, Moses might be guilty of wanting the same thing, to truly behold the face of God. But just like some of our most earnest prayers, God didn't answer Moses in the exact way that he wanted. Instead of beholding God's glory fully, Moses could only see in part. The full revelation of God would have to wait, It would have to wait for the birth of Jesus Christ more than 1,000 years later. Because in the face of Jesus Christ, we do behold the glory of God. And when we fully stare into Jesus' face, behold his radiance, indeed we are transformed. We are called again on a journey in which we do die to self in order to live for God. In this season of COVID-19, I think we can all agree that we are praying for an end to this pandemic, for life to resume a sense of normalcy. However, I have to wonder if God is inviting us to wait. I have to wonder if God is inviting us to be transformed in the meantime. Moses never lived to see Jesus' birth. He never saw his prayer fully answered. And yet, God accompanied Moses and the Israelites on their long journey, nevertheless. They were transformed. They were remade together. And is it possible that that's what God wants for us now? Might it be that God wants us to rest every day in the newness of God's grace and mercy and love? Whereas God didn't get to see God's glory or God's face fully, we have the privilege of knowing the fullest revelation of God in Jesus Christ. God has revealed God's self to us. We have beheld God's glory in Jesus. The evangelist John reminds us that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory. Glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and full of truth. There is no longer any separation between humanity and the glory of the Lord because we behold the face of Yahweh in Jesus Christ. He is one with the Father and the Holy Spirit, and he is the new mediator who perfects our prayers and intercedes on our behalf to the Father. In this difficult time, as we yearn for a return to normalcy in a season of calm, let us turn our eyes toward the glory of God and behold the face of Jesus. Let us, like Moses, pray boldly, knowing that the Lord might not exactly answer our prayers as we see fit, but instead let us seek after God's transformation. And let us take this time to allow the Spirit to work on our hearts to sow seeds of love, mercy, grace, and justice in our hearts so that we might reflect the glory of God back into the world. Amen and amen.
The word of God has been proclaimed in our midst. We are now called to stand and affirm where we have seen God's glory among us. We do so today using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray. God of light, we praise you as the one who shows your glory to the nations in the coming of Jesus Christ. We thank you for reflections of your glory in our world and in our community, for your work in the beautiful creation around us, for your work in the world, and for your work in the church and community. Help us to see these signs of glory as signs of your coming kingdom. We long for the fullness of that kingdom. Come, Lord Jesus. In light of your love, we come to you in the name and power of Jesus Christ, and we pray for the creation and its care, the nations of the world, our nation and its leaders, our community and those who govern, the Church Universal, its mission and those who minister, our congregation and its ministry, the people with particular needs. We offer all of these prayers in the strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Come away to the skies, my beloved, arise, and rejoice in the day thou wast born. On this festival day, come exulting away, and with singing to Zion return. We have laid up our love and our treasures above, our bodies continue below. The redeemed of the Lord shall remember his word, and with singing to paradise go. We sing to our Father and King, and his rapturous praises repeat. To the Lamb that was slain, alleluia again. Sing all heaven and fall at his feet. To the Lamb that was slain, alleluia again. Sing all heaven and fall at his feet.
We are Christ Presbyterian Church. God has called us to the city center of Canton and out into the woods of Sharedsville, that the goodness of the gospel of Jesus Christ might be proclaimed here and beyond. Again, I welcome you to Camp Wakanda. What a great, great morning. Thank you, Michael, for a wonderful sermon. Thank you, Britt, for beautiful music. Thank you, Brian, for bagpiping. Is that what bagpiping, I guess, is the word? Thank you for Brian, the other Brian, for allowing us to video and make everything happen out here for broadcast tomorrow. life of the congregation continues even in these days, these difficult days. For instance, the youth group is meeting weekly at 4 o'clock via Zoom, and sometimes in person, but they have also taken on a project, so I would encourage you to take a look at the back page of your order of worship, and you'll see their care package project, and you can help them send care packages out to recently graduated high school students. I was going to say graduated high school students, just to remind them in particular that they are children of God and they are still part of this faith family. Remind you also that Sunday, October 18th, a couple weeks from now, there is a concert, a broadcast concert. You can find that on the back inside cover of your order of worship. There are many other things that are there to pay attention to, ways to be involved. I'd remind you again how critical the Friday email is to the congregation, because in that email you will find Zoom invitations and information how the church is gathering in new days and new ways, and the links to all of that. So I really do encourage you to participate in that. We cannot be afraid of failure. If we don't try something, we've failed automatically. But Michael, Ben, and I were attempting this, what did we call it? Chat with the pastor. Sunday, 9:30 in the morning. And to be honest, it just hasn't flown very well. So I know 9:30 on Sunday morning is a rather critical time for me. I could be doing something else. So we have stopped that. Nevertheless, there are book studies, Bible studies, all kinds of opportunities, choirs to participate in. Make sure you participate there as you are able and encouraged. Finally, just a very quick note about spirit and space. And I say this because I was able to spend some time in the sanctuary this week just sitting. And as you spend time in that place now, you begin to get a feel for what it will be like. There's enough shape and contour to the new environment that you get a very strong sense of what is coming our way. And therefore, a public thank you to the Spirit and Space team and those who've been working so hard, because I've already begun to sense the presence of God in that place. And I'm grateful, because I think you folks will be eternally grateful for the transformation that is happening, and that space which we will return to soon, we pray. All that said and done, I again thank you for making the trip out here, and I hope it has proven worthy of your time. We know God is worthy of your time. We prepare to enjoy the camp for the rest of the day, or move on to the rest of our day. As we do that, let us close with a final hymn.
Our hymn is hymn 81, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken. Please stand as we sing. Things of thee are spoken, Zion city of our God, God whose word cannot be broken, formed thee for a blessed abode, on the rock of ages founded. What can shake thy sure repose? With salvation walls surrounded, thou mayst smile at all thy foes. Round each habitation hovering, see the cloud and fire appear. For a glory and a covering, showing that
that the Lord is near, thus deriving for the banner light by night and shade by day. Safe they feed upon the manna which God gives them when they pray. See the streams of living waters springing from eternal love. Well, supply thy sons and daughters, and all fear of want remove. Who can faint while such a river ever flows their thirst to assuage? Grace, so like the Lord the giver, never fails from age to age.
Friends, our benediction is sung and together, for we are God's people, sharing together in the glory of God's presence here and now. So I invite you to look around at your neighbors, to sense God's glory in our midst, and as we sing the song that we end our days here at camp with, shalom. Shalom, my friend, shalom, my friend, shalom, shalom. We'll see you again, we'll see you again, shalom, shalom. Shalom, my friend, shalom, my friend, shalom, shalom. We'll see you again, we'll see you again, shalom, shalom.